This episode is sponsored by Squarespace. Go to squarespace.com/microcosmos to get a free trial and 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain. There's this idea in science that people sometimes cling to that assumes our understanding of the world has to be built on rules and guidelines. And there are times when that rigid foundation makes sense. In microscopy, knowing the rules that govern the way that microbes live and the way that light bounces around the world goes a long way towards being able to keep those organisms alive and illuminated. But science is about more than just finding some immutable laws of nature. It's about having the imagination to try and ask questions that might not necessarily lead anywhere, but that just feel right. Questions like, what happens when we add ink to our samples? And how do you make bubbles in the microcosmos? Some of you might already know the answer to the question of how James, our master of microscopes, has made bubbles in the microcosmos. We talked about it in an episode about how microbes respond to electricity. For that episode, James safely ran a small current through water to generate oxygen and hydrogen gas. So, why does electricity make bubbles in water? Well, the current breaks water apart into oxygen and hydrogen gas, creating bubbles along the wire where it touches the water. And for James, the bubbles were a really fun sight to capture under the microscope. But they also inspired ideas for different experiments that he wants to carry out, like seeing how the hydrogen gas might affect some of his samples. And that's the very same spirit that has been guiding microscopists for centuries. Take this slide, for example. It probably looks like James accidentally spilled some ink on the slide, which is in fact almost exactly what happened. There is ink on this slide, but it didn't get there by accident. James added it on purpose. As different paramecium swim in and alongside the ink, you can see the trails they leave behind, a record of the paths they took along the slide. Many of the early observers of paramecia relied on ink to understand the organism. For example, Herbert Spencer Jennings published works in the early 20th century that described the movement of the paramecium's oral cilia, movement that he was able to see using India ink that he had added to the water. The movement of the cilia was recorded in the movement of the ink. There's something lovely about that image, almost as if the paramecium was an artist creating a self-portrait out of the tools provided by an external observer. Of course, that's not exactly what the paramecium was doing. It was just an organism splashing around in some ink. But there was an artistry to Jennings' work. In one paper, he mentions that he found India ink to be preferable to other inks like carmine or indigo, thanks to its color, fineness, and lack of chemical reaction. And James, well, of course he did his own experimenting as well. Specifically, he wanted to know what would happen if he added an invisible ink that becomes visible under black light to his samples. So he went to a stationery shop, bought some pens, and squeezed the ink out onto a slide. And when he illuminated these samples under UV light, the results were spectacular. The shining blue parts are the ink, and you can see the way they create these beautiful galaxy-like structures that other organisms swim through. Some of the experiments that James does, like this one with the invisible ink, are about making beautiful things that might help him study the microcosmos in new ways in the future. But sometimes his experiments are much more practical. For example, when he started microscopy, all of the books and papers that he came across described a very important skill for microscopy called micropipetting. This technique helps you grab just a tiny bit of a sample from your slide, the way that James is grabbing a single tardigrade here. To do micropipetting, you need a very thin tube, and traditionally, scientists use glass pipette tubes as the starting material for their micropipette. They heat the pipette over a Bunsen burner and slowly stretch the tip out so that it forms a thin, hollow tube. But for James, this became a problem because it required a lot of glass tubes, and that became quite expensive. So the micropipettes you see him using here are in fact made from plastic. It took a bit of experimenting for James to figure out the best way to turn these pipettes into a micropipette, but eventually he figured out how to use a lighter flame to carefully heat up the plastic tips and stretch them out. And even after that, it took James months to perfect the process of actually using his plastic micropipettes. It's tough work, you know, trying to chase a microbe around a slide with a pipette. In the beginning, he kept losing cells. But eventually, our master of microscopes also became a master of micropipetting. James put a note on this script here that says, "When I micropipette a tardigrade, I feel like I'm beaming them up to the mothership." And James's experiments continue. He's always on the hunt for new techniques to enhance his microscopy. Sometimes that has meant big changes, like upgrading his microscope. Other times, that's meant making small changes to the water his organisms live in, like adding ink. But for his next experiment, he's been messing around with the actual slides that he uses to watch his organisms on. Usually, James watches organisms on clear glass slides, you know, the typical slides used by microscopists all the time. But lately, he's been trying out something different. This is a geode slice that, as you can see, James has laid out onto his microscope. And even before we turn the microscope on, it is quite stunning. And then, once you turn the microscope on, the details embedded in the geode become this gorgeous landscape with stunning layers and colors all splayed out. And when James turned on the fluorescent light source on his microscope, he was surprised to find that the slices show autofluorescence. After digging through some papers, he suspects that these bright bits are created by certain trace elements in the lattice of the geode. But going back to the idea of these geodes as a landscape, James was inspired to see if he could actually use these slices as a slide. So he added a drop of pond water to the geode and placed a coverslip on top. And we think the final product is super cool, like if the microcosmos were set against a desert. There's an almost science fiction quality to watching the nematode here frantically wiggle against this backdrop. And again, this is largely an aesthetic experiment, though who knows what scientific questions it may help James explore in the future. That is part of the joy of microscopy, a skill that combines scientific and aesthetic components. It's not that microscopy has to be pretty, but the ways we construct the images we see in microscopy inform the scientific lessons we learn from it. Plus, sometimes making beautiful things is just fun. It's an experiment in its own right, a series of questions like, what happens when I do that? And I wonder what other people will think when they look at this. So for those of you who use the microscope or any other tool like it, we hope that it helps you explore the world with the aim to not just understand nature's rules, but also to see its beauty in new ways. Thank you for coming on this journey with us as we explore the unseen world that surrounds us. And thank you to Squarespace for sponsoring this episode. Squarespace is a powerful online platform that helps you create your own website. So whether you're looking to create an online portfolio, start a blog, or even create an online cooking course, Squarespace can help you out. With its new guided design system, Squarespace Blueprint, you can create a unique online presence from the ground up with professionally curated layout and styling options. And with integrated optimized SEO tools, your content will show up more often and to more people. Squarespace also offers robust analytics to monitor traffic and sales, giving you the data you need to grow your audience. And with Squarespace, you get to set the price for viewers to access your content, whether that's a one-time fee or subscription, or members-only content. And with flexible payment options, checkout for your customers will be seamless. So go to squarespace.com to sign up for a free trial, and when you're ready to launch, go to squarespace.com/microcosmos to save 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain. And thank you to our Patreon patrons, all of the people's names that you're seeing on the screen right now. They are our patrons on Patreon. They're the folks who have let us experiment and share on this channel for years. Thank you so much to everybody on the list here, whether you've been a patron for years or just for a couple of days. We appreciate you so much. If you want to see more from our master of microscopes, James Weiss, and why wouldn't you, you can check out Jam and Germs on Instagram. And if you want to see more from us, there's always a subscribe button somewhere nearby.